So let's start. Welcome to my talk. My talk is about security for developers. So a little bit about me. I'm Nanda Baars. I work for a company in the Netherlands called JDriven. I work as a Java developer. I worked in the past as a Java developer as well. I moved a little while to be a security consultant, and now I'm back in development. And I'm one of the project leaders of a project called WebGoat, and that's how this whole presentation started, and during my work as a security consultant as well. So what is WebGoat? WebGoat is a... who knows WebGoat, by the way? Well, some people, that's nice. So it's a vulnerable web application where you can learn about security vulnerabilities which you should not include in your daily work as a developer. In the new version, we started with a new setup. So what we do now is we start with explaining the vulnerability. For example, we explain what an SQL injection is. Then we do a couple of small assignments. And then in the end, we will explain how to mitigate that kind of vulnerabilities. And then in the end, you get one big challenge where you have to really prove that you know how that security vulnerability works. So why is it still important? Jeff Williams, he's the original developer of WebGoat way, way, way back. And a couple of years ago, in 2016, there was a PayPal had a two-factor authentication bypass where he had two security questions. And if you just remove them in the request, you would just log in again. And that was also a lesson in WebGoat as well, because that was the whole idea of this lesson, is you had to log in and you had some security questions, you had to remove them, and then you passed the lesson. So also PayPal did exactly the same thing as which was present in WebGoat as well. So this is how it looks. This is an assignment. So this is an XML external entity attack, and you have to try to make it work. We also made it a little bit more realistic in the current version. We also made a WebWolf, so you have WebGoat and WebWolf, and WebWolf is more like the attacker's point of view, so that you also learn what the attacker needs to do on the other side, so not only you as a developer, but also on the other side what the attacker should do. So here you see a password reset, which is also a lesson in WebGoat, and the attacker has the ability to get that email, and you can click that link and you have to solve the lesson. So I can skip this one. So the agenda is as follows. I will first introduce why security is important and why it should be incorporated within your daily process as a developer. And then we will move to hopefully 10, not sure about timing, but hopefully we'll finish all of them. I will show you some pitfalls, some bad practices, and some tips. So as a developer, this is basically standard what you do. You write some code, you write some unit tests. You probably perform a peer review, or you do pull requests with GitHub and stuff like that. You write functional and performance tests, and you probably measure some quality with Sonar or whatever you use for that. This is a nice picture, which I found on the internet. It is about Jenkins, and Jenkins is the CD DevOps ecosystem. And you have all kinds of tools in all kinds of phases, so you have build, scan, release, deploy, and stuff like that. But there is nothing in it for security, so that's kind of weird. So I want to show you a couple of examples of security failures. So this is the first one. This is a website which leaked 1.4 billion passwords. This is another one. I was not aware of this one. This is AI.type, something on the iOS phone. And what they did is they had full, it is a keyboard, and what they have is that you have full permission for the app to work. But what was found by security researchers is that, let me see, there was a MongoDB database on the internet, and it contained that amount of data for all the users which used that app. So everything, so like swiping, typing, email, credit card, they all had that information. This is another one. Let me see, this was a brute force attack, and the passwords were leaked. And the issue here was that an older hashing algorithm was used. And it was kind of interesting because they moved to bcrypt that year. But what was happening is that this one was not used correctly. So the hackers were able to revert those passwords with an instant. So this is another one, which is kind of interesting, because all of a sudden on the internet there are open S3 buckets, which is kind of interesting, because an S3 bucket by default is protected, and you have to do something to make it open to the internet. And kind of interesting to see that security researchers are now looking for open S3 buckets. So what was happening here? It was a Viacom website, and they had an open S3 bucket. And in that S3 bucket, there were all the keys. So all the keys for all the customers, for all the FTP servers, everything. And it was open to the internet. So it was kind of interesting to see that such a company made such an interesting mistake. So here you see it. Somebody found this out in the S3 bucket. There is a simple Python script. And here there were the AWS keys, which he blacked out. But OK, it's for the that was open for the internet. So it was kind of interesting to see. Well, what most of the time is happening, security is an afterthought. So most of the time, security tests are only performed just before you go to production. So who works in a company? You all probably work in a company. Well, I worked for a bank. And what we needed to do just before we went to production, we had to get a check mark from a pen tester, which came in 2 days. He said, well, the application is fine. You get a green check mark. And then you were allowed to go to production. So that's not how it works, because I also did that kind of work. And when you come in, they give you the application, say, this is the URL. You have 2 days. Please verify for us if the website is safe or not. Well, that's kind of impossible to do, because 2 days and finding all the issues and saying that the application is safe, that's impossible. So. Also, development really moves to CI/CD, and security has no time to catch up. And the result is we have vulnerable web applications. So this is why I got started into this, because I worked at a bank, and I was involved in all kinds of security testing. So I was not being the pen tester, but being the one who had to distribute all those reports to the teams, explain the vulnerabilities, what happened, and stuff like that. And what we always got were simple findings. So you get these kind of reports. Probably you've seen before, and here you see that the cookie HTTP only flag is not set. Well, that's something you get from pen tester. They come in, you pay them a lot of money, and they give you this report. But these are simple things. You can test them yourself. So if the team just add a test case, my cookie should always be protected with HTTP only. You're fine, and you can move on. So you don't have to pay a pen tester, which costs like 200 euros to find this kind of vulnerabilities. What you want is a pen tester who looks at these kinds of things. Like this is a weird example, because this was somebody who found a Chrome browser bug, and he was able to bypass the CSP policy. So that's an extreme, of course, but these are the things we can easily test, and these are the things which you want from a pen tester. So this is a kind of I found this picture on the internet. It was kind of illustrative for what I was thinking about, because this is more normally how it works. Well, you can picture either one of them. One cat is the developer, and this is the security officer. And the security officer by default says no. Developers are by nature very inventive, and they find ways around security policies. So I once was at a company where they were not allowed to query the production database. But of course, the web application is able to communicate with the web application, with the database. So you can almost guess what the developer did. He built a small hidden page inside the web application where he can just type in the queries, and the result would come back in the web application. So he was just bypassing one of the security officer rules, which just said developers should not be able to connect to production. They don't have an account on production. So I think we should move to this model. where you work together. So the security officer or security team works together with development to make more secure apps. Luckily, we are moving into that direction. So it's going in the right way. So I first want to start with a very simple one. This is about secret management. I see this a lot. You probably heard about this example, where somebody checked in his S3 keys on GitHub. And he found out. And what he did 15 minutes later, what he did, he just did a commit again to remove those keys. Well, that does not work because there was a bot already. There are bots scanning GitHub for every commit. And they look at whether they can find S3 keys or whatever they can find and do something. So he woke up the next day and there were a lot of EC2 instances just mining Bitcoins for him. And his money, he had an account of $50,000. He had to pay to Amazon. Well, Amazon in the end said, well, okay, this is a mistake. It's not really that bad. But it kind of illustrates my point because most of the time, this is what we do. So we check something in, a password for your Postgres database or whatever. If you search on GitHub, you can find interesting things. Maybe it doesn't work, but it kind of gives you an idea. If you look for Postgres and you look for the database and you look for the query string, you will find something. They might not work, but they give you an idea how that password is most of the time. There are some patterns to be seen, so you can guess in the end what maybe the password is for production or whatever environment, or maybe it even works. I didn't try. So that's kind of... So what you need to do is you have to have a policy in place. So if you check in keys to GitHub, the most important thing is not to undo the commit, but to... change the password immediately on all the servers related to that that key. So it could be S3, could be a Postgres database. You have to change that those keys. And then after that, if you did that, then you can undo the commit in the end. So also, this is something, if I leave a team, it's also funny to see that you can still log in. Probably also have GitHub accounts where you're still part of the organization. And there is absolutely no policy in place with a lot of companies to remove a user because GitHub has its own management. GitLab has its own management. AWS has its own management. So that's kind of something you have to think about as well. If somebody leaves, have a policy in place. These are the services we have to remove him from. So this is kind of a nice one. It was from Snapchat. And it was on HackerOne. They had a Jenkins instance open to the internet. So everybody with a valid Google account could log into the Jenkins instance of Snapchat. That's not good, because Jenkins most of the time has, it has all the APIs keys. It can deploy. It can do a commit to GitHub. So if you can log into that server, you have all the keys to the kingdom, and you can do whatever you want. So there was this bounty was paid 15,000 euros, because it was very simple. But yeah, the disaster is there because everything is on the Jenkins server as well, credentials, everything. So this is something you can easily automate, because what you can do is just get a server on the internet, and just like an attacker, just go to your own Jenkins server, and it should never be open to the internet, and you can do all kinds of testing. But be aware, because I was at the company once, and we also did this. And we were not allowed to get a server on the internet to do this kind of testing. And we had an internal server. But most of the time, you have some kind of weird proxy rules inside an organization. So we were not able to reach it from the inside because of proxy rules. But we were able to use it from the outside when somebody tried it at home. So be aware that you have to do it from the outside to the inside. So as the same, look at your environment the same as the attacker does. So also for the S3, if you have an S3 bucket, just make a test case and Jenkins job, which runs every 10 minutes or something. Just check whether that S3 instance is not available publicly. So the second one, this is one of my favorites. It's an old one. It's about an SQL injection. We'll probably all know about an SQL injection. So here you say, or 1 = 1. And you're logged in because 1 = 1 is always true, so you're logged in. So if you read on the internet, the mitigation is always use prepared statements. So why is this still important? And this was found in the Joomla instance, it's a PHP application. And this was found by a scanner, and they updated the scanner, and all of a sudden they found it. And this was found in 2018. So what was the issue? The issue was over here, app install null, and app install null is something the user can insert to the application. So it is very simple. Only the developer didn't see that this one was actually this one, and you could just get this one from the outside. So a user can manipulate this app install. So you can do whatever you want here, and you can get the database and all the information. So this is kind of an issue. This is an interesting graph. It's a graph about potential SQL injections copied in Stack Overflow. And somebody made a graph about, you have all the questions and people start copying and answering all different questions and you get all kind of SQL injections and they are copied, et cetera. So that it's still like 700, 800 are still copied around on the internet. So it scanned for this one. I'm not saying that all of these are by default SQL injection related, but some of them look kind of scary because if you look here and here, it just gets from the post a name. Well, I think you can manipulate that. Maybe this probably is not validated. Or so if you look at this query. So here we have an SQL query. So we select star from users where name equals this one, equals name. And we order by this one. And we use a prepared statement here for colon name. That's most of the time how you use a prepared statement. And this one. Suppose this one is something we get from the request parameters. So my question is this query vulnerable to SQL injection? I see somebody nod, probably heard about the issue as well. So indeed, this query is still SQL injection, although you use a prepared statement here. You can't use a prepared statement for the order by clause. That's just not possible because it will only substitute parameters and not the order by statement. So how does it work? So here you see the definition of an order by is a column name, expression, position, and ascending and descending. So what happens if we do stuff like this? So here we say we use an expression and we say select case when true, then a last name and else a first name. And the other way around, if you do false name, then you short by a first name. So if we put this one into here, so we say this substring, I will explain a little bit. This is MySQL, where you can just get the information, schema system tables. You ask for a table name like users. You get the first character of that one. You cut and you ask for, does it start with an A? So you're looking for combinations with the table name users. So it can be, let's say, webcode users. So you have to guess. You know there's probably a user table, but you want to know how the table is called. Because if you know that, then you can ask that table about the information. So what this does is, so if I start with an A, it will be false, and then it will be sorted by first name. If we go on and on and on, and we have a W, then it will be true, and then we will be sorted by last name. So looking at the website, you actually know, you're asking the database a question, the database replies with the sorting. So you sort by first name or you sort by last name. So that's kind of how that works. So what you need to do is you have to validate those extra order by columns as well. So you have to do validation. So this is kind of interesting because this was also an issue in GPA, so Spring Data. It was also an issue. And you were able to inject all kinds of stuff because it was kind of easy to do because you could order by, or there are other ways to do this. You can order by the sum of stuff. You can order by function. So it was kind of handy to do this. So now they restricted it because it was indeed a bug. So somebody posted an issue on the Spring Data web blog. And you can only do it by domain object and the fields. So they do the validation based on the fields. And if you want to do it the other way around, so if you want to do something weird stuff, and you have applications which need to support that, you can do this, gpa.unsafe. And that unsafe should give the developer the intention that look out, because this might be not be the best idea in the world to do. So moving on to the third item, which is about content type checking. I see this a lot of times where developers are kind of sloppy about not checking the content type, making it open, and you can do whatever. So this is kind of an interesting thing. So see, I have a simple REST controller which gets some blocks. It's in Kotlin, by the way, but it's Spring Boot based. I can create a new block, and I can just list all the blocks. So if we focus on the post mapping, so if we do this, we do a curl with a JSON body, we get back a 201 created. If we change the content type and we use the same JSON body, we get this error. So you get an unexpected character because this one is not expected, the content type XML. And it's giving you, Spring Boot is giving you an error. Or Spring, by the way. But if we do this, so we do the content type XML, and we start doing this, we just post an XML, it's all of a sudden a 201, and we have this one, the JSON back, which creates the block entry. So this is kind of weird, because when I first encountered this, I was like, why does this work? And it turns out, because you have both the JSON dependency for XML and JSON on your class path, Spring is trying to be helpful and tries to help you by saying, oh, I don't care if you do XML or you do JSON, I know how to parse that, I will do that for you. So that's kind of default behavior. I would expect the other way around, but okay. So this is how it works. This is the famous HTTP message converter. And you see here that it puts in the mapping, JSON, and the XML converter. So the question is, can we exploit this? And then we first have to go to another section, which is XML entity attack, which we're like saying first, and then I will come up with an example of why this actually can work. So this is the OWASP top 10. The OWASP top 10, maybe you heard of it, but it's a top 10 about the most important security risk. It's kind of for OWASP, it's kind of a way to get developers aware about security. So they're trying to help developers what kind of issues to look for. And since 2017, the XML external entity attack is back, and it's immediately on place 4. It's not that it's that common, but if you have an XML external entity attack, the impact is very high. So you can do a lot of things if you can actually pull this one off as an attacker. You can do a lot of things to the web server. So we'll see in the next couple of slides. So what is an XML entity? Well, this is how it used to work. For me, it's also been a time to when I did XML. But if you do this, you have a doc type, you say author, and you say here the entity JS is Joe Smith. And here in the author, you reference that one, and it's called a DDD. And the parser will just make the author Joe Smith. So you don't have to type Joe Smith everywhere in your XML. You can just reference this entity here. The parser will see that it's defined as Joe Smith, and it will replace it in the end. So what is the XML entity attack? It's an attack that parses the XML input, but it references an external entity. So I will show you an example. It's easier than the definition. So here you have an XML message. You say, I have an author. It's our block author example again. And I say here, show me. And show me is defined as, give me this file, etc password. Etc password is on the server. And you can see it. And if you get it back, the parser will go to this file, reads this whole file, and puts it in your XML message back to the client. It's not guaranteed that the application reflects the whole XML back, but you can also do kind of like same with SQL injection. You can also do blind attack. So it's not important that this comes back to you directly in the request or in the response. So this one is the classic example of why this works, because if you do this, you see here, the lols all this billion lofts, is this called, and what this does is you have here this one, you reference this one reference this one reference this one, et cetera, et cetera. And when the XML parser parses this message, you will consume more than 3 gigabytes of memory. So that's basically one message, game over for the server. And your server, if you send 2, you have 6, so the server will not, it will go down. That's an easy DDoS attack, because you only have to do 1 or 2 calls and the server is down. So this is another example. This is what I said about, well, it's not reflected. You can also do stuff like this. You can say ping, and you say here, this is my website, hacker.com. And if it works, you will get a call on hacker.com. So if you host this website, you will see in your log file an entry coming from the server, and you know that the XML attack works. So remember the first one, the previous one, when I talk about the content types, JSON and XML. So this is basically how it works. I have to move a little bit here. This is JSON. By the way, this is an XML mapper, so I skipped all the classes above, because there are a lot, but this is basically where it drills down to. You have an XML mapper, which creates an XML factory. So this one is this one. It passes null, null, null to this one. And here it is an XML input factory, which is null. So if it's null, it will create a new instance. And since 278, it explicitly says false for the attacks. So the external entity tag does not work anymore because the parser is no longer allowed to do to accept the inside its own XML message. Spring, this is how Spring Boot does it. It creates an object mapper for you, which is an XML mapper. And Spring does it a little bit different because this one was already in 2016. And Spring already did it in a good way. So they did like this. They set it to false, the same as here at the moment. So this is all fine. But going back to my example, I found this on the internet. So somebody was asking him at Stack Overflow, how can I consume XML with a Spring Boot application? So somebody said, well, you can do it like this. You just create an object mapper, XML new instance, and you register that HTTP message converter, and you just override everything, and you say application XML, and you provide it with the object mapper class, XML mapper as a subclass of object mapper. And this is how you can do it. But let's follow that example. So if we do that and we do a curl and we put in this test message, we put in this message, and here I say blog is referencing to this server, which is on my local host. So I'm the server running on port 8080. I have a netcat listening on port 8090. And what happens is I get a reply. So if I send in this message, I get a reply because this one, Java 1.8, is my application running on this port. So this application actually makes a call. Well, this is just a simple example. You can think about lots of ways because you can also read in files, pass them along to the request parameters, and you can do all kinds of stuff to do that. You can also reach services behind. I'll show you an example later on. But this works. So why does this work? Because if you look, this is the killing part, is this one is, is calling this one, and you say new instance. And remember, if this one is null, it will do the safe one. But due to the fact that we did it ourselves and outside of Spring, you get into an error because this is true by default and this is true by default. So just by making one simple coding example mistake, you just end up with true, and you're open for XML entity attacks. So a better name for this one would, of course, be create unsafe parser, because new instance is not telling me anything. It probably, if you really want to do this, you probably want to know about, okay, I'm doing something which I really need, and it's not exposed to the internet, so I'm really sure that I can do it. But then a better meta name would be create unsafe parser, because the developer then knows, hey, I'm doing something which is not, has maybe some effects on my application. So you probably wonder, does it still work? It does. Last project I was on, we did a lot of XML messaging, and when I came aboard, the first thing I did, because I know about this attack, I created a unit test for this application, and the parser was configured correctly. Everything was fine, because by default, Java does configure the parser in a correct way. And then all of a sudden, we had a pen tester, and in production, and on the acceptance environment, we were running a Docker container with Wildfly, and we used a base image, which pulled in a different XML parser. And all of a sudden, we were vulnerable. The unit test was green, but on the acceptance environment, we were just open. So the pen tester came out, and I was like, why? Wait, what? Because we tested it. How can it be? And found out that this Docker image, Wildfly, and there's a base image, and there's another base image, and then you end up with something with J, and that that indeed gives you a Java version with a parser which is not configured correctly. So always, if you do something with XML, it's best to just configure, create your parser, but in your application, explicitly set those two those properties to false, just to make sure that you don't end up with this one, because this was kind of embarrassment for the whole team, because we were pretty sure, and the pen tester said, well, he took about an hour, and he found it, so it was kind of embarrassing for us. So this is probably most of the time how it's used. Suppose you are an attacker and you want to do something on onlineshopping.com. Most of the time, companies have a firewall in place, so the attacker cannot directly communicate to this application. So what he can do, So this is not possible because of firewall rules and stuff like that. What he can do is put in something like this. So if you have an XML entity attack, you can just put this one in your request, and it will end up on this server. And it's not. It takes a lot of time because first the attacker has to find out what is this server and what kind of commands does it, what kind of endpoints does it expose. It takes a lot of time, but once you have this one, so suppose this is a SAP database or whatever, they have an API, and because this one is allowed to reach this one, you can do stuff like this. So that's. It takes a lot of time, but once the attacker is able to do this, he can do anything he wants. So he can create a user maybe and stuff like that, and then he can log in, and from there he can just move along and break in your application. So this is called a server-side request forgery, and this one is then combined with an XML external entity attack. So this is also something which I find, I will go very quickly, this one. It's simple, you find this a lot. Authentication based on HTTP methods. You have it in Spring Boot, you have it in Java EE. It's copy-pasted all over Stack Overflow. I'm not sure why, because you can do it in the other way, you can just do it with path or your whole application. But suppose we take the Spring Boot example. We have a delete mapping, and we have a get mapping. Of course, delete should never be a get, okay, but if you scan your source code, you will probably find some endpoints which do change state on your with a get. So, and we have one to find all the blocks. So suppose we do this, we do a curl to load to all the blocks. We get a 401 because it's basic authentication and you have to log in. Suppose we do this. We do a head, which is also an invalid HTTP method. You all of a sudden get a 200. And you get the content length of all the blocks. So in this case, it's the content length of all my blocks, which is more on that server. So if you do this, the head of this delete action, you get again 200, no content length because there was nothing to return from that one. And if I again do a head for all the blocks, you see that the blocks were removed. So please do not do your authentication based on HTTP methods, because the head is implicitly a get, and because you did not define the head, the get, the Spring and also Java EE will see, okay, this is a head, which is implicitly a get, but it does not enforce the same rules for that get method as it should, because it's a head request, and you did not specify to do authentication for the head method. So this kind of something to be aware of. So the next item is JWT tokens. Probably you're all familiar with these kinds of tokens. So how does it work? You have a browser, you have a server, you log in with your username and password. The server creates a JWT with a secret, and when you send in another request, you have to put the JWT token into the authorization request header. The server checks that JWT token, and you move along. So it's for stateless applications where you don't want to mess with cookies. You can use the JWT token. So this is how it looks. The token, so the red part is this part, the purple part is this part, and this is the signature. And the second part is the payload. And the payload is what you put in it. So you can put whatever in it, but please be aware that although this looks like a garbled message, it's not. It's just Base64 encoded. So please don't put anything here in here which identifies the user completely. If you want to put sensitive information in this one, please use encryption for the token as well. Sometimes you decrypt the token and you see all kinds of information like telephone numbers and stuff like that. And why? Why do you put it in the token? Because you can just read it in the server, in the client side. So this is kind of interesting. If you use the JWT parsers, which are all over the internet for Java, you say parser, set signing key, you set the password, and you have the access token. So what happens if we change this token? So if you change the token, you implicitly, the signature is no longer valid. So if you go back to this one, if you make this true, this signature will no longer validate, because the HMAC of this whole message, of this part, will no longer match the signature here. So every small change is the signature will not validate anymore. So, but what if we do this? So we say JWT JWT tokens have the option to say algorithm is none. So if you say algorithm is none, you move this to admin is true, and you remove the signature part and you leave the dot in, this will just work because that's how the specification works. But the funny part is that the libraries have two methods. So if you use this one, you can use this one or you can use this one. If you use this one, you end up here because you set the signing key. And with the signing key, it tries to validate. The algorithm is none. There is no signature anymore. So the token is not valid because it cannot check the signature. But if you do use this method, you just end up here. So that's kind of why did the this kind of weird because here you use parse. So if you just type in like IntelliJ, you just type a set signing key dot parse, you just find this method. And you will say, oh, that works, but it doesn't work because this still works. This does not validate the token at all. The token is valid, but not the signature. So setting the signature has no effect in this method. So there is another way. I was this is a little bit more. Here you use public private key to sign the token. You can change that one to use the HMAC of the public key. You get here the HMAC of you put in the algorithm to the HMAC, and you can just sign any token you want. And if you don't check whether the token uses this one, you will have a success in the end because you can just change the token. People on the internet, people started complaining about that the libraries made mistakes. But if you look at the specification, this is exactly how it should work. It's not like it's more or less the specification fault. And you have to be aware that you have to check the algorithm used in the token. So you get the token back. The first thing you need to do is check the algorithm. Did it change? No, I expect it to be HMAC. It should still be HMAC. If I set the signing key, then there should be a signature. So you have to be aware that the libraries are just following the specs. It's not the library's fault. It's more or less the spec fault, the specification fault. And people started working on a new, of course, because why would you use this one? So to counterfeit the design decisions made in JW.tokens, they create a new one. And there are support for PHP, Go, Ruby, and some other. And there's no support for Java yet. So this is probably maybe a new standard. It's just some maybe. So on the other hand, I also was a security consultant at a lot of teams where they wanted to use JWT tokens. But it also gives you a lot of more responsibility because if you think about a browser, we have cookies since day one of browsers. So all the errors which were made with cookies, the browser just solved them because no longer they do not longer work. You cannot override cookies anymore, stuff like that. HTTP only came along. So the browser is protecting you a lot. But with JWT tokens, you're on your own again. So you have to think about how should I block a user? Because JWT tokens are supposed to be stateless. So there is no state. You cannot have you cannot go anywhere to ask for, is this token blocked, yes or no? So that's you have to think about it. And you get interesting discussions if you want to use access tokens and refresh tokens. And also, if you have a refresh token, sometimes you can use a different access token to get a refresh token for somebody else, which is also some things you have to think about and how should you validate. And also, where do you store them? You can use a cookie, something. You can also put them in the local store of your browser or a session store. But then in the end, if you do that, and if you have a cross-site scripting vulnerability on your application, people can just get those tokens easily. And a cookie is protected by HTTP only, so it's more difficult to do that. So you have to think about a lot of things before you start using JWT tokens in your application. So the next subject I want to talk about is about cross-origin resource sharing, which is interesting by itself. This is how it works. So if I have a simple jQuery, and I want to go to this application is running on port 8083. This is my server running on port 8080. And I want to make a call from this server to this server. So if I do that with a simple get, I get the request goes this way. It comes back with a 200 OK. And the browser says, well, this is a violation of the same origin policy because this server does not have cores enabled. So the browser blocks you from seeing the response. The request is made to the server. Same with post. If I do a post and I say this one is application form URL encoded, this one goes here. If you have an endpoint, which it could be that you use form parameters, and you didn't check your content type, you might be able to even do this if you're not checking your content type over here. So you might be able to do a post to this one. It's just an example. And this one is created. It should be different error code because I removed something. But in the end, the browser is saying, I blocked the request because there's no course on this server and you're not allowed to do that. If I do the same with JSON, something else happens, because if you do JSON, all of a sudden there is an options request going to the server and it says, I want to do a post and this is my origin. And then this server replies with a 403 forbidden. So there's a difference, because if you do a post with a normal post with this encoded, the response does reach the server. Only the response is blocked by your browser. If you do this, application JSON, because of the pre-flight, the second call is not made because you first do the options and then you get a 403 forbidden back, and then the browser does not make the call for doing the post. So there's a difference in those two. So why is there a difference? The pre-flight request is not done automatically. It's only done when you do you add a header to your jQuery or whatever you use for a JavaScript library. But if you do a post, get, and a head, and the content type is one of these, and there are a lot of headers which I did not specify here because the list is quite of long, so content type, all of kind of default headers which you are allowed to use, the browser will not do a pre-flight request. So that's kind of interesting to see. So if you enable course, you say here, I do port 8080, this server is now course enabled. You will get back from the browser, access control, allow origin star, and you are allowed to see that. So now the browser say, okay, you are allowed to see that information and you will see all the blocks. The same goes with if I do a put, for example, here I do a put with an extra header, and because of the put and the extra header, this is sent to the server. I want to do a put, and this is the pre-flight for the options, and I have an extra header called x something. I want to add that to you. The server responds with, you are allowed as an origin. These are the methods. I kind of missed that put over here, I see. And here you have the header is also allowed. So these are the content type, and there are more, but these are the two which I just picked up. And then you are allowed to do the put. So with the header, x something with else. That's fine. So that's how course works. Now the interesting part, well, this is kind of how you, if you look on the internet, if you ask, you type in Spring Boot, enable course, this is the default thing you will find, which is absolutely, but this is not what you want, because not every request to your server should be course enabled. You may have a get or a simple post, which you want to have course enabled, but all your other methods should not be course enabled. Why? Because this just does it for your complete application, which might not be a good idea. So with credentials, it becomes interesting. So if you have a cookie for this website, you have a cookie in your browser, I want to make that call, I have to specify here with credentials. If I make that call again, the get goes to the server, the cookie travels along, because the cookie is not, with this one, it always sends the cookie, and you get back, allow control access credentials are true, so the server says yes, you may call me with credentials, so I support that, and the origin is also supported, so you can make that call. Now it becomes interesting, because here is where it goes wrong, is that this combination, luckily, the browser doesn't accept this, because this would be horrible. If the browser, if you do star and true, then every random site on the internet could make a cross-origin request with credentials to your server. So that would be a gold mine for attackers, because you can just create a website, make that course request, and if that user is logged in, the browser has the cookie, the browser sends that cookie along, and you can make that request from your hacker site as well. So the browser says, well, I'm not going to do this because access control allow origin is star, so I'm just blocking this whole thing. That's not possible. But then you come into an interesting world, because you can't specify this. You cannot say, I want to do it for test.com and example.com, and I want to say allow credentials is true. You can only have one allow origin returned back to the browser. So you have to reflect it. But then it becomes interesting, because what happens is that a lot of frameworks just reflect everything. So you see here, I do this on a different port, and then put a hack me, and they just and the server just replies with, okay, hack me is fine as well. It's not star, and this is interesting to see that reflecting every site means basically that you as a hacker.com can also do the same. So the browser is helping you with star and true, but if you reflect it on the other side, every origin, and so you go with the origin hacker.com, the server says, oh, I'm just reflecting that thing, hacker.com is fine by me, and by the way, you can also do credentials. That's just horrible if you want to do that. So there was an interesting talk about on YouTube, you can find it, and somebody was able to steal API keys from a Bitcoin website site, because what they did is they actually reflected the header. So what they did is he just made that call, and he was able to make that call from his website, and he had to send a phishing email to one of his users, and he said, click that link, you go to my website. His website made a call to the Bitcoin website, they reflected the origin, said, oh, fine, I'm logged in as well. So he stole the credentials of that Bitcoin site. So that was fixed within 5 minutes or something. When he reported this, it was fixed in 5 minutes because they saw how much, that's kind of oops. So this is what I found on the internet, this is PHP. And here somebody just made the effort to, in comment, specify, okay, decide if the origin is one of you want to allow. If so, then do this. Later on, I Googled for the same instance on Stack Overflow, and somebody just removed the comment. It's almost the same. I'm not exactly sure it's the same. It's the dates are the same. So the if, blah, blah, is also the same. It's kind of interesting to see the copying Stack Overflow. And the funny part is, even somebody mentioned in the comments, there was a whole discussion about should you reflect it, do star, and somebody said, well, I agree that control allow origin is star is insecure, but actually that would have been more secure because then the browser would have helped you and said, no, I'm not going to do this. So this is I saw that movie, that YouTube video on the internet, and I just made this Spring Boot application where I did exactly the same, and I said origin is foo. And I go to my website, and what Spring Framework does, it reflects. And it says true. So this is kind of what the whole presentation was about. Is this is horrible if you do this. So I made an issue on the Spring Framework, and they fixed it already. So I was testing last night, and why doesn't it work anymore? They fixed it already. So it's in Spring 5.5.0.2. They fixed it, so now they return star. So if you don't do anything, and you say allow credentials true, and they just don't reflect the origin anymore, but they just return star, which is more secure because the browser helps you and says, well, I'm not going to send those credentials, and I'm not going to make that request for you. So the last thing I want to talk about, just to be quick, is about the password. So here you see a nice GIF from Intel. You see how complex password can be. This is interesting to see that the NIST made a password recommendation, and the guy who did that, Mr. Burr, now is sorry about that he ever said that you have to change them regularly and that you people started doing this. So you have to change it after 15 days, and people started doing password 1, password 2, and he now realized that was a bad thing to propose as in the specification. So now the NIST specifies something like this. Even this, so they made some guidelines about the minimum length, the complexity of the password, and stuff like that. And they also said that you have to check whether that password was part of a previous breach. So you may have heard about the website Have I Been Pwned? Troy Hunt is he has a list of all the passwords, and in his new API he has a website called pwnedpasswords.com. And what it does is it actually gives you the ability to check whether a password was on a list. So if the user creates a new, have a website, you create a new user, the user types in a password, and he types in password, and then you can check with his website whether the password was part of a breach. Because if it's part of a breach, hackers probably can easily guess that password. So how does that work? Because it was supported in version 1 as well. But then you were sending the complete password in a SHA-1 to the server. So people complained about that might be a breach, because if there's somebody in between, you see exactly which password the user wanted to have. So that's kind of not what they work. So together with Cloudflare, they created anonymity, which is a property to anonymize data to a certain level. So what it does is you take the password, you take a SHA-1 of it, you get this one, you take the first 5, you go to that API, and you get a complete list of passwords starting with this one. So it's by range. So there are a lot of passwords, and you have to do a lot of work to get the original password back. So that's kind of interesting, and NIST now also proposes that you implement this in your web application. So I created a small project, which is simple. I just used the API, but what I did is I created a Spring Boot starter. So if you want to use this, you can just use this project in your Spring application. You can just wire up that bean, and you can just check your password, and it will do all the work for you. I will go quickly. So this is plain password. You shouldn't store plain passwords. This is using a hash. That was the second iteration where we all ended up. Then you get the same hashes. So you can easily guess what the password was. Then we started using salts, which was also not a good idea. And this is also not a good idea because this is looks interesting. It was a SHA-1 MD5. And this one is killing because this one just flattens the whole scope of guessing the password to the power 32, which is easily to guess. So if you find a match, you have the password. So please do not invent your own way of doing stuff. Just use the algorithms. So the best way to do it at the moment is bcrypt. Use bcrypt, scrypt, or pbkdf2. Password derivation functions, which have some kind of computable cost. So it takes a long time to get the password. And you can see here, you put in the cost, the salt, and the password. And out comes the hash. And the hash you store in a database. If the user logs in, you do exactly the same. And based on the cost, it takes a lot of time so brute forcing this, it's getting difficult. It's not impossible. It takes a much longer time. So there's some also the sometimes you see the concept of a pepper. How does a pepper work? The pepper works as follows. You have a server which has this key, which is the pepper. On the other side, you have the database, which has the verifier and the salt. And if this is SQL injected, this database, you only have this one and the verifier, but you're missing this one, because to get the whole verifier, you're still missing the pepper. So you can't brute force it you can, but it takes a long time because you're missing the pepper. You have to breach this server as well. Those are connected, but SQL injection is more more easily done than maybe breaking this server. Well, there's another way to do it, which is a little bit the same. You use bcrypt, you get the hash password, you have an encryption key on your server, and you do symmetric encryption, because if you do that, you can just change your server has been breached. You can do stuff like this because you knew the encryption key and you know how to do to reverse this one. This is also something to be aware of, is and don't try to be bcrypt. As you saw before, if you do this salt plus pepper here, the outcome of the bcrypt is this hash. And actually, this is pretty bad because this pepper should be secret. But bcrypt just stores it in this format, and the pepper is also here. So the pepper is automatically added to that outcome of the bcrypt algorithm. So be aware of this one. Also, this one was funny, is if you do the if you make your websites accept passwords which are like megabytes, the key derivation function never terminates because it has to take too long, and you have DDoS on your server as well. Two-factor authentication is also something you can implement on your website. But also be aware that this is not completely, it's another layer of security. But in the end, you still are able to, an attacker is still able, it's more work, but you can just make a screenshot and present the user with something you sent. So there are ways to attack and the two-factor authentication as well. So scanning QRs and stuff like that, it's easy to, it's not that easy to do, but you can do it in the end. So the most important thing is, monitor. So if you implemented all your password things, please also add this monitoring. So if the user normally logs in from this location, and all of a sudden you get a login from this one, and 2 minutes ago he logged in from this one, block that user. The user will probably call, but in the end, this is just weird. It can be that he is on holiday, of course, then you may have to say, okay, fine. But you can also think about, if he logs in from this location, you can also ask for a step-up authentication. So maybe send an SMS or whatever to do a second authentication factor again. So, well, I have more, but 10 is not, I'm not going to make it to 10. So where you need to start is you have to start to make security. Well, we went through a couple of examples, and you see that all the things are in the little details of how you implement your source code, and a mistake is easily made. So do a code review and please make yourself aware of that the security vulnerabilities within an application. Well, this is one that's important as well. Create a security guideline. So if you do a pull request and you do a review, have a security guideline and besides your a review. And what I see a lot of companies do is they download all kinds of tools and they throw all that tools towards the application, and you get back a lot of results, and you get a lot of results if you do that. So you first have to start with defining your security guideline. What is important? What are the threats for my application? And then you can start using those tools. And the tools can easily find obvious mistakes. So that's kind of why they help you. And please, thank you. And please try out Webcode, because that's my open source project I'm working on. You can just download it. It's a Docker file. You can spin it up as a simple jar, as a Spring Boot application, and you can just start learning, because doing an SQL injection is something else than knowing about an SQL injection. It's sometimes complicated, and that order by kind of illustrates how it's in the details and not. So that's it. Thank you very much. Maybe questions. I've been a little bit over the time, but okay. Thank you.